There's the straight forward approach. Pastor, did you know there's a towel on your shoulder?
Grace, mercy, and peace from God our Father and our Lord and Savior Christ Jesus. Amen. The text that I'm going to preach on today is a text that I had some time to study this last week. The book of Romans, chapter 3, verse 19 through 28. Paul writes, "Now we know that whatever the law says, it speaks to those who are under the law, so that every mouth may be stopped and the whole world may be held accountable to God. For by works of the law, no human being will be justified in his sight, since through the law comes knowledge of sin. But now, the righteousness of God has been manifested apart from the law. Although the law and the prophets bear witness to it, the righteousness of God through faith in Jesus Christ for all believers. For there is no distinction, for all have sinned, all have fallen short of the glory of God, and are justified by His grace as a gift, through the redemption that is in Christ Jesus, whom God put by His divine forbearance. It was to show righteousness because of His divine forbearance. He had passed over former sins. It was to show His righteousness at the present time, so that He might be just and the justifier of the one who has faith in Jesus. Then what becomes of our boasting? It is excluded. By what kind of law? By a law of works? No, but by the law of faith. For we hold that one is justified by faith apart from works of the law." Kind of sounds like confirmation, doesn't it? I got a rather humorous story to tell you. I was going to bring a prop, but I didn't. When I was a student at the seminary, we were required to go do an institutional module. Mine was at the hospital across the river in Illinois. I went to the hospital once a week, and I remember one day that instead of going from the seminary to the hospital, I went home first to put on my black clerical clothes. For my daily assignment, I only had one patient to see that day, and I knocked on the door, and I went in by the gentleman and his family, mind you. Listen to that, gentleman and his family. And I introduced myself. He seemed to be in high spirits. After all, he was going to be released the very next day, and we prayed and I left. The visit was a success. All was well and everybody was happy, or so I thought. Did you ever have something you wanted to tell someone but didn't know the right words to say? When I got to my car to travel home after the hospital visit, a reflection in the rearview mirror caught my eye. That's when I noticed it. It was there during my entire visit in the hospital, and nobody told me. You see, when I'm at home, I have a habit of putting a dish towel over one of my shoulders. Can you tell where this is going? You guessed it. I wore that dish towel during my entire hospital visit. Probably thought I was going to go wash somebody's feet. And nobody said a thing. The lady at the information desk, she didn't say nothing. The people I rode in the elevator with, up and down, they didn't say a thing. The nurse at the nurse's station, oop, not a word. The gentleman or patient or his seven family members that were there. And then after the room visit, I had stopped at the cafeteria to grab a cup of coffee. Do you think they said anything like, "Oh, sir, the napkins are over there. You don't have to bring your own"? No! I was really embarrassed. But it works for good for sermon fodder. Do you ever have something you want to tell someone but didn't know the right words to say? I'm sure all of those people in the hospital wanted to say something but didn't know how. I can just imagine the conversation. There's the silent sign approach. They could have done that. There's the shy, covert approach. Mister, you got a towel on your shoulder. There's the straight, forward approach. Pastor, did you know there's a towel on your shoulder? We've all been there, either on the telling side or the receiving side of the conversation. What about other instances? You kind of need a Kleenex. Ladies, how about your dress getting caught in your pantyhose? I tell you what, I have seen that one more than once. And gentlemen, let's not forget to check our barn doors now and then. Or how about, you know, you kind of need a Tic Tac. Or you have something right there in your teeth. Well, my favorite, did you use deodorant today? How do you start those conversations? Suddenly our body language speaks louder than words. We become shy. We become unable to speak and use gestures or subliminal messages or swiping our nose or blowing our nose or the list goes on and on. Sometimes it's hard to get these words out. Did you ever have something you wanted to tell someone but didn't know the right words to say? How do you find the courage and the words to say what's on your mind? It's never easy telling someone something that needs to be said that could easily cause embarrassment to you and or other person. Where do those words come from? As an example, in Romans, thankfully we have Paul as a guide in these awkward situations. Paul wrote to the Roman Christians to enlighten and to encourage their faith. The new believers were confused because the gospel message was being twisted and distorted. Some unwise people were telling them that believing in Jesus wasn't enough. His dying and rising on the cross was not enough to make them right with God. They were telling people that they could only be made right with God by doing good things, or we know it as good works. So Paul, he needed to open the dialogue with the faithful Romans to gain their trust and to rebuild their knowledge and their hope in the true gospel message. But where to begin? How do you start that conversation? You start it with God's grace and peace. The opening to the letter to the Romans: grace to you and peace from God our Father and our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Sound a bit familiar? I try to say that every week. Sometimes I forget, but I try to say that every week. Those words that he used put the baby Christians at ease, reminding them what comes from God. It comes grace and there comes peace. Then he moved into talking about his message. Now, there's no doubt Paul was not shy, or he was a man of few words. He was on a mission and he knew what needed to be said. Using simple words, he spoke his mind, regardless of causing embarrassment or hurt feelings. Let's look at what Paul said to those baby Christians. Verse 23 of the scripture text I just read, he said, "All have sinned and fall short of the glory of God, but here's the good news. They are now justified by his grace as a gift through the redemption that is in Christ Jesus." Paul reminded the Romans that all are guilty of sin and are unworthy of God's blessing. However, because of Jesus Christ, who died on the cross in exchange for our sins, we are justified, or we are made right by God, by God's grace-filled gift. All have been made right with God. We need to hear the message of justification because we need to understand how we are made right with God. Working to earn brownie points with God is bogus. We don't even earn our way to heaven, so we can't earn our way into heaven. So heaven, salvation isn't a paycheck. It is this instant that we can only stand before the Almighty in quiet awe because we are sinful. We are completely sinful and we have completely failed Him. So how can we earn God's grace? What can we do? What can we do to earn God's grace? Nothing. We can do nothing to be made right with God. That, my brothers and sisters, is the beauty of God's grace. God does everything. It's like it's a full service thing. God does everything through faith in Jesus Christ and God's wonderful gift of grace. We have been made right before Him, and we have peace with our Creator. Do you ever have something you wanted to tell someone but didn't know the right words to say? I do. And I tell you, remembering that at the heart of the Reformation movement was the gospel, the good news that by grace through faith we are justified, I have been trying to figure out a way for the last 8 months, almost 9 months. Do I do it by newsletter? Do I do it by letter? Does everybody kind of already know? You've heard me talk about me and my dogs. Well, for 9 months, I have been single occupant of my house. We are going through a divorce that has been approved and guided by the district president and the council of presidents. I've been trying to figure out how to tell the congregation this, but I haven't figured out how to tell the words. But reading this scripture, I realize that these words could cause me embarrassment. Luther pointed out all the flaws of the church that they could cause embarrassment, and I understood that these words I just told you could have caused me embarrassment, but they had to be said. It was extremely difficult. I kept saying, how do I tell them? Do I tell them in a newsletter? Do I tell them on devotions? Do I just wait and hope everything works out? But this started long before Christmas. How do I tell them? I tell you firmly and boldly. Never before have I been surrounded by so much love from a congregation. Even though our pews are pretty much empty, never before have I felt so much love, so much support from the people who have known. Never before. And so I tell you with a humble heart, I tell you knowing that you all will give me grace and you all will trust me. And you all will give me blessings. But it was extremely difficult. Did you ever have something you wanted to tell somebody, but you didn't know the right words to say? I got another thing. How do I start the conversation with you? Like Paul and Martin Luther, that God loves you and His grace-filled gift, we are justified. How do we ever begin to explain the gospel message that Jesus Christ died on a cross for you? Where do those words come from that allows you to understand our God is full of love and forgiveness? It comes from right here, the Holy Bible. Here, the Bible, the Word of God, the words come from here. Did you ever have something you wanted to tell someone but didn't know the right words to do so? I hope so. Like Paul and Martin Luther, we are challenged to talk to other people about God's love and His grace and His peace. People don't know there's hope unless we share the good news with them. Talking about your faith can be very difficult sometimes. It can even be embarrassing. But we have the words found right here in this book to help us explain our faith. Sometime this week, I want you to tell somebody about your faith, even if it's somebody you already know. Find the courage to say where your grace comes from. Discover how passionate you are for God's love. And share that good news with someone else. And keep sharing it and sharing it and sharing it. And I guarantee the right words will come to you. The chapel kids, we always sing a song together. Jesus loves me, this I know, for the Bible tells me so. Little ones to him belong, they are weak, but he is strong. Yes, Jesus loves me. Yes, Jesus loves me. Yes, Jesus loves me. The Bible tells me so. What's the Bible? The B-I-B-L-E. Yes, that's the book for me. I stand alone on the Word of God, the B-I-B-L-E. If the kids can understand it and sing it, so too can we. Find the words. If you have to tell somebody something, find the words from Scripture and from the Holy Spirit. Amen.